Cinnamon, where you gonna run to? Cinnamon, where you gonna run to? Where you gonna run to? All on that day, will I run to the rock? Please hide me and run to the rock. Please hide me and run to the rock. Please hide me, Lord, all on that day. But the rock cried out, I can't hide you, the rock cried out.
I would like to thank you for this warm invitation to come and visit today.
It's our pleasure. Now, tell me about your childhood. You said that it seems like your childhood is the backdrop to your writing. Now, how has that influenced your creative production?
I think that everyone's childhood is the backdrop to their current life. I just think that those of us who are writers are able to trace it in a more obvious manner. But my first novel, Leaving Atlanta, is based on my childhood experience. When I was a girl in Atlanta, there was a murderer that killed about 30 African-American children in about a two-year period. And I wanted to write a novel, not about the case, you know, not a mystery story involving police. I really wanted to write about the way that experience changed the growing up of an entire generation. And so that was really what my mission was with my first book. Because when I would tell people that I grew up in Atlanta during this time, they would say, oh, you know, you didn't have a childhood. And I would say, yes, you know, we had a childhood. We had a strange childhood. And that's what I wanted to do with my first book.
Do you think that your childhood, that was in Georgia, right?
Yes, Atlanta, Georgia.
Do you believe that your childhood might have been different had you been born in another American state, say California, Minnesota?
Oh my goodness, yeah. I was going to say that Atlanta is a very distinct place, but I think every place is a distinct place. Like, you can't interchange. If you change your experience, you change the person. So I do think that my experience in Atlanta changes the way I understand who I am. For example, I think of myself as I'm an American writer, I'm a Black American writer, but I'm also a Southern writer. I feel very much grounded in the Southern part of the United States and the way that history has impacted the culture there. A lot of writers don't like to be labeled. They say, oh, don't call me a woman writer, don't call me a Southern writer, don't call me a Black writer. But I think it's really important that you call me all these things. I don't mind labels as long as I can have as many labels as I like. I don't mind, in the US, bookstores, they have these special sections where it may say African American interests, something else might say gay interests, all these different kinds of sections in the bookstore. And people sometimes get really upset, like if they enjoy my work, they say, oh my God, you know, I was in this bookstore and your work was, you know, in the Black section, and how can this be, and maybe we should pick it. But I really feel that it's all still in the bookstore. Like, if a shelf says African American interest, and someone decides not to go there for that purpose, who has the bigger problem, my book or that person, if they're afraid to walk across, you know, to walk across the room to look at something because it has a label? So my question, are labels the problem, or are people's fear of labels the problem?
So do you write when you want to write, or do you have some kind of an agreement, a deal with the publisher? They tell you, like, you have to produce one book every 2 years or so, or?
Oh, no, they only do that for very famous writers. Like, writers in the middle, you have to motivate yourself. They won't come to my house and demand another book. So I let the story tell me that it needs to be written. You know?
And were both books published by the same publishing company?
They were. They were both published by the same publishing company. But I wasn't on a contract or on time. I finished it when I finished it.
Then you go up. Have you received invitations from other companies to to get your books published or to produce a new book through other publishers?
What they do is they don't make an offer until they see the next book, but they do little cute things like they find out where you're going to be and they, you know, they compliment you, they say they like your hair or whatever, because it's considered rude to compete with another publisher. It's almost like you're a married person, and so they can't directly say what they want. So instead, they say, "No, my, don't you look lovely?"
Let me interrupt the interview for a while to invite Professor Gomez Imad to join us here on the stage. I'd like you to kindly please kindly welcome Dr. Gomez Imad. Just give him a
One of the things I look at in a novel is the uses of English, your characters. Do your characters, this is something I'm very curious, as a linguist, do your characters use authentic speech? Is the authentic speech of a Tata represented?
I sure hope so. I try, particularly in, well, I try to look at the way that speech kind of indicates not only region, but also class, and it's a way that I try to differentiate the speech. But I try to write the way people speak, but one thing I don't do is that I never change the spelling of words to indicate the way that characters pronounce them. I feel like that demeans the character. So I try to establish a speech pattern by which words they use, not how they say them.
Interesting you're making that point, because your president, whom we all admire, does do that. He represents speech in Dreams from My Father. He uses the so-called I dialect, or G-O-N-N-A, and these half dialects,
well,
so forth.
I do use G-O-N-N-A because I feel that that's actually has become a contraction. It's become a blended word. So that's, I think, the only one that I use, but I don't. For example, I would never take the G off of an ing word. I would never do that. I would never do it.
How about using an apostrophe to indicate the omission?
No. I don't believe that.
Well, that's a writer's right. It's one of the writer's linguistic rights. In your bio data, there's mention of advocacy. This is something I very much admire in American organizations and institutions. There is usually a group or a committee in charge of advocacy. They advocate, for example, human rights, peace, justice and peace, non-killing, which I'll tell you about after your interview. And what kinds of advocacy are you engaged in?
My work or in my life?
Both.
Well, in my life, I'm actually a member of a wonderful organization called Girls Right Now, Right with a W, because it's been discovered that only about half of girls in New York City finish high school, finish secondary school. And we've discovered that if we take these girls and match them with a writing mentor, and just by writing their own story, that they become engaged and committed to their education. And our organization has been around 10 years, and we have 100% success rate. And over half of those girls go on to university. So right now, that organization is my passion. I'm vice chair of the board of directors for that organization. So I really believe, though, and I think it ties in with what I believe, why I think literature is important. These girls are able to reach a level of success in life through finding their voice, through writing, even though they're not publishing or anything like that. But just by two things, putting pen to paper makes them aware of their life, writing about it makes them think about it, and then having the mentor, which is someone who will read their work, both those things, in creating the writing and knowing there's an audience. So speaking and being listened to, that combination is what changes their lives. And I think the same is true for published writers, but just on a bigger scale.
I understand you do workshops on creative studies, creative writing studies. Is that literature focused, or all genres are? considered?
We do fiction and poetry, but the classes, the people who write fiction are on one track and the poets on another. But the main text of these classes are the students' work itself. So the students submit their work, copies for everyone in the class, and then we critique it. And that's how they improve. And so it builds a community among them. Because once you graduate and you're in the world as a writer, it's very lonely. Especially if you're a fiction writer. If you're a poet, you have maybe this one piece of paper you can say to someone, would you read this? But if you're a novelist, you have 300 sheets of paper. No one wants to read that. But if you have a group from school of other writers, you can exchange. Because it's such a gift for someone to read your work. And that's something that they have this community that follows them even after graduation.
Yeah. If I may interrupt, if you don't mind my co-hosting, there's just a question that sort of preempted my question. I was going to ask you, is there any secret to any formula to motivate people to write? Because sometimes, you know, this is a language school, mostly, among other things that we do here, but we as teachers, we find it somewhat difficult to motivate people to write. Sometimes you mention the word write, you ask people to take out a piece of paper and a pen, and some people feel almost offended. You know, they go, oh my God, write. No, I hate that. No, let's do that for homework. And then you set up for homework, they don't bring it. You know, so is there some magic wand that we could, you know, like, and motivate people to write? So maybe what you said about these people getting together into communities, that might be motivating.
Also, I think a lot of people are afraid to write because they feel their writing is judged. They're not afraid to write, they're afraid to fail.
Oh, I see.
And they feel that a lot of times in classes, if you're asked to write something, it's because someone wants to evaluate your grammar, they want to evaluate your English, not that they're interested in your idea. See, when you say, oh, write this, they think it's about the writing, but if you ask them to speak, what is your idea about this or that thing? They speak freely. People want to be heard, but they just don't want to be judged. So it's a way that you have to convince people that the way that you want to know their ideas. Also, I think it's important that, I'm sure you all know this, that there's one way you talk and then one way you write. Like you feel like you have to write in your writing voice. And it's not your true voice. And so we really encourage students to write in your true voice. When I ask a student to write something, it's because I want to hear their voice. And that frees them up, you know.
Well, maybe that's one of the reasons why they refuse to write. Because being a language school, at least some of the writing will have to be graded, you know, somewhat for language, you know, vocabulary, sentence structure. And then that's where the fear is, perhaps.
That's exactly where the fear is. As people want to do well. They want to be affirmed. They don't want to try hard and fail. So it's a way of, we do two kinds of writing. We do this thing called free writing, when you just write. You're not judged. You just get all your ideas out. And then later drafts, we work on grammar, etc. Because I think thinking too much about grammar and it'll be like it'll block the ideas from coming. If you write it and write it wrong, we can work together and fix it. But if you're too afraid to write it, I can't fix it. I can't help you fix what doesn't exist.
Yeah, I know. But this is such a sort of deeply rooted idea that sometimes people who produce some text, they expect to be graded, or they expect to get some feedback on the language that they have produced. I mean, syntax-wise.
I believe it should be later in the process.
Yeah.
Like, I've learned that the first time I write a novel, it's so horrible. It's like the worst thing, and I worked so hard on it, and it's so terrible, and that used to be very discouraging. But now, I understand that's just how I do it. I write it once and it's terrible, but I know that's one step on the way to doing it properly and it doesn't depress me anymore. I do the terrible thing and then I do it over. But the first time is just to get it out, to feel like a child with my thoughts and just play around with it. And then improve it later.
Yeah.